What is going on, guys, and welcome back to another video with your host, always, K-Mac Time, and today we have a very special video. Before we get into that, I want to announce a brand new giveaway that I am starting to right now for this amazing Venture Bros art book hardcover. And you guys have seen a picture of it right here. I actually ordered a couple off of Amazon. They're not here yet, but all you guys have to do to enter to be entered into win a chance to win this is A, like the video, B, be subscribed, and C, leave a comment down below letting me know what your favorite Venture Bros moment is. Now, after you do all that, you'll be entered to win. You guys can get bonus entries by joining my Discord server, by liking my Facebook group, and following me on Instagram. All those links will be down in the description down below, and I'll announce the winner for those hardcover books in about 2 or so weeks, depending on how many entries we get. And then I'll get your information and ship those out to you. But this book is really cool. It's very, very high quality. It's very similar to the Rick and Morty one, which is also one of my favorite art books out there. So it's hardcover. It's very cool. If you're a fan of the show, it's something you want to look into, you know, how they make the show, how they do all the stuff like that. It's very interesting. So make sure you start liking that like button, subscribing, and leaving a comment. And you can get your bonus entries by the stuff in the description. But with that out of the way, guys, let's jump right into today's video. Today, I want to start discussing some of the Easter eggs and hidden references and missed jokes about Venture Bros. Now, if you guys aren't familiar, I did this with Rick and Morty last season, on season 3, and it was pretty popular, and a lot of people enjoy the things like that. And Venture Bros has got a very similar style of hiding things or using references you may not understand or you may not get from older shows or from old pop culture that you might not be familiar with. So you go back through a little bit of research, and the jokes and the shows and the episodes become that much funnier. So with that out of the way, guys, let's just jump right into this. I got a few things. I just want to say here that I am not perfect. I will undoubtedly miss a ton of references and callbacks, you know, things from previous seasons that I may have forgotten about, or pop culture references that I just didn't understand myself. So if you guys pick up on something that I may have missed or left out of this video, by all means, go ahead and drop it down in the comments. Let's get a community going on here. Let's get some things going on, a collab. We can come up with more of these. And the more we talk about it, the more we discover through sharing like this, the better. And also, I want to say that this is going to cover the very first 3 episodes, but I do plan on doing videos in the future per episode. So next week, it'll be all about episode 4. But because there's only been 3 episodes out, I'm going to just kind of glum all the ones I found from those 3 episodes together into one video. But let's get that out of the way. Oh, and also, I'm going to start including some stuff from season 6 in here in the beginning. Starting off with this. This is a screenshot from the episode back in season 6 called Tarzan, or called Party for Tarzan. And in this, we see this kind of like scene, or it's like 2 seconds where Helper is staring at Problem in the Venture complex. And you don't really think anything of it back in that episode. Didn't really make any sense. But knowing what we know now, it's kind of this weird foreshadowing. So I thought I'd throw that in there. So that's a clear foreshadowing to the events of season 7, which we know happens with, a lot happens with Problem, or Problam, as it's called. Also, the thing is, if you guys didn't know, Serena's character, who is the Wide Whale's daughter, obviously, Serena's character, her name is as a play on the Sirens, or Serenes, which is commonly referred to as sea cows. All they're like this big, fully aquatic herbivore mammals, much like her dad is, like a whale, basically. So you get it, like Sirens, Serena. It's kind of like also an Italian name, so it fits perfectly. You may not have picked up on that. Another thing that's really cool about this is that Sirens are actually supposedly the origins of the mermaid myths. Back in the day, you know, sailors would see these kind of big sea cow looking things, and then they haven't seen a woman in so long, and it's kind of how they started this whole myth of a mermaid. And they kind of play to this in the show. Remember back in season 6, when Hank finally was on a date with Serena, and they get in the water, and she's got like her lower half in the water, and he can only see her top half, and he asked if her lower half turned into a mermaid. Also, another thing worth mentioning here is that in most of season 6, when he's around Serena, Hank is dressed somewhat like a sailor with his white shirt and blue handkerchief, further explaining his attraction to her. So it's a pretty cool little thing right there. They kind of like go along with those little themes there. I actually like that one a lot. Now, getting into season 7. Now, most of episode 2 was a play on the movie Jaws, and I absolutely loved this. There's a lot of screenshots here. The characters were wearing similar outfits. A lot of the things, the themes were similar. Basically, the whole episode is just one giant parody. There's a scene where Dr. Mrs. the Monarch gets slapped on the pier. That's like a shot for shot out of Jaws. There's the Red Death volunteering to find the Blue Morpho. That's the exact same thing that happens in Jaws when the guy volunteers to bring in the giant shark. And there's just countless other scenes and little references thrown in there. But the best one has to be, obviously, the infamous parody of the We Delivered the Bomb speech from Jaws, which is one of the most heart-wrenching and best moments in cinematic history, really. And Red Death parodies that with his, obviously, we talked about the Movie Night Massacre, about the females or the stab girl being sucked out into space and dying in front of her. Very, very similar to what we saw from We Delivered the Bomb speech, where he talks about being on a shipwreck and being stuck out in the sea and then having to watch his friends die to sharks. Very, very similar there.
We dressed as crew members. Some of us had our space suits on, some of us didn't. With this face, the helmet never came off. Went perfectly. Flawless. Well, until someone opened the bay doors. No one knew who did it. The crew shot out like their mamas were ringing the dinner bell. You ever see a man die in space? You can tell the ones that held their breath. Their lungs rupture from all that gas expanding. Blood from their mouth like a torn pillow stuffed with red BBs. Stab girl, she was a little thing, carried switchblades. She knew to exhale. Watched her for a full minute. Puffed up like she'd a peanut allergy, floating by me with her mouth open, screaming, making no sound, spit on her tongue, boiling. Anyway, got to see a little Sharky's machine.
Also, the Sharky's machine is like basically the standard 70s, early 80s cop drama. It's the thing they talk about. It's actually the movie they played during the infamous movie night. It actually stars Burt Reynolds in real life. It was released in 1981. And like I said, the whole movie night incident, this is the thing where Red Death is actually talking about it. And it's actually a callback to Season 1, Episode 2. The whole movie night thing is a callback to Season 1, if you guys are unfamiliar with this. It's actually a throwaway joke back in Season 1, Episode 2.
Those sure are dandy fine spacesuits you boys got.
It's kind of creepy in here. And cold.
When it gets cold like this, I always remember back when I was a paperboy. On this station? I must have been about your age, and on a night just like this, one of the crew just suddenly cracked.
Cool!
He gathered everyone in the hangar for what he called movie night. And under the flickering light of Burt Reynolds' Sharky's machine, he opened the bay doors. Almost the whole crew was there. Sharky's machine.
Where the astronaut are on board the Gargantuan One, his name's Manstrong, was trying to scare Hank and the boys by telling them this basically this ghost story, this big horror story about movie night. And back then, it really was just kind of a throwaway. But they've since, you know, of course, brought that whole thing back. And now it's a major plot line in Season 7. And I think it's really cool how they're going all back 15 years ago. They wrote that episode as a throwaway joke. And they're going full circle on it. And they're bringing Program into it. And it's just a whole big, all this is a big callback to Season 1 and all that. I don't know if it's been retconned or if it's been how long it's been planned, but either way, I really, really enjoy it. Also, if you pay close enough attention, you'll notice in that episode that Brock's clothes, the clothes he's wearing in that episode in Season 7, are the exact same outfit that he's wearing in that Season 1 episode when they're on board their Gargantuan 1. So that's pretty cool as well. Another thing we see here is this wide whale flashback about his origin story, where he tries to impress his brother by stealing a gigantic shark piece of art. And he said he stole it from some swanky art gallery, and it's worth like $12 million. But the funny thing about that is, this piece of art actually exists in real life, and it's called The Physical Impossibility of Death in the Mind of Something Living. I know it's a mouthful there. But it was created back in 1991 by Damon Hirst, and actually features an embodied or embalmed shark in this big canvas of, like, I don't know. It's really cool piece of art. It actually exists. And on top of that, it last sold in 2004 for, get this, $12 million. So again, the amount of detail that they put into these one, like, throwaway one-line jokes or little scenes that don't even need that level of detail is what makes this show so great. A little one here, if you take a freeze frame on Serena's computer, you can see a lot of stickers on the back of it. It's very commonplace for people to put stickers on the back of the laptop. But we zoom in on one here, and it's a clear reference to the band The Misfits. So they have that same kind of logo. It's a pretty cool band, and I thought that's really cool that Serena's a big fan of The Misfits. Now, starting back in Season 6, if you took a close look at the Vantech Tower in New York, which is the complex, you can see the skyscraper is built on top of a much older building, and which is basically their grandfather's building, their company before them in New York. And the words Carl Lloyd Venture, Automata, and Millinery Co. Now, you know, that may not mean a lot to you because it's kind of a throwaway here, but milliners actually is a word, an older word you may not be familiar with, is people that make hats. So I didn't know that until I looked it up. I'm like, what is a millinery? What does that do? They make hats. So it's an old word because who the hell makes hats these days, right? Anyway, milliners have a habit back in the day of going crazy from mercury poisoning, which was used to treat the felt to make the hats. And it would actually, the mercury in that would make people lose their minds and go crazy, which is where we get the term mad as a hatter from. So that's pretty interesting. Also, when they are summoning the spirits in episode 2, I believe, we see these victims of a Venture factory hat fire in 1907 that was caused by a Zeppelin. I thought that was pretty funny they put that in there. But the spirits are actually saying they locked us in as the fire burnt. Now, this is a very dark reference to the Triangle Shirtwaist Fire that actually happened in Manhattan in 1911, where a felt factory caught on fire and the factory's owners locked the doors, trapping the employees inside, causing hundreds of them to burn to death. So that's a clear play on that, and I thought that was pretty interesting that they went that deep and that dark on it, but I actually really enjoyed looking that one up. And I also didn't know what a millinery was, so it's kind of a two-pronged thing there that I was really impressed by their writing there. Another little throwaway joke here is when the monarch asked why White Whale dressed Hank like a gigolo to kill him, he responds himself saying that he dressed himself as a juggalo. This is a pretty funny reference here. If you're not familiar, a juggalo is a fan of the real-life band The Insane Clown Posse. So it's kind of funny, like, they're just a little throwaway joke. You may not know what a juggalo is, but I thought that was pretty funny they included that. Also, we see in the flashback of Vendetta getting his memories back, it says that he walked 1,766 miles to his old home in Newark. Now, the really funny thing about this is, like I said, the attention to detail that the writers put in this show is outstanding. Now, where he was before, previously, was in Colorado Springs, and it said he walked to Newark, where his home is. That is actually, the real-life distance is 1,766 miles. Another very unnecessary, doesn't really add a whole lot, but it's hilarious when you find these things out. And I love the little attention to detail like that. Just a quick little search here, it shows that it is the exact distance that he walked. Also, in the end scene of one of the episodes, the House of Triad is looking to buy a new house. And they say that, like, this one has a Doctor Strange window. It's actually pretty funny. And it gives like a real life address there in the Lower East Side of Manhattan. And that house actually exists. It's actually a synagogue in the Lower East Side of Manhattan. And it has that really weird Doctor Strange window like that. So that's another little detail you may have missed. Is that is a real life location. Coming up on the last few here, guys. We see that a cowboy and Indian toy was inside of Pro Blam, and which caused the Action Man and his friends to trip and drop the frozen body of Jonas, causing him to shatter. That's why it's just his head in there. And that is, again, another callback to Season 1, Episode 2, where the original problem with the space station was a cowboy and Indian toy. So they're going full circle on that one as well. I thought that was pretty funny. In the flashback from Red Death's flashback, we see a villain called Mr. Fahrenheit. This is a clear call back to the singer of one of my favorite bands ever. That is the lead singer of Queen, Freddie Mercury. He looks just like him with the same kind of mustache. Fahrenheit's a pretty good play on that. I thought that was pretty funny. And lastly, if you remember back to Season 1, Episode 2, we've been talking about it a lot here. The astronaut Manstrong says he was aboard the Gargantuan the night that the Movie Night Massacre occurred, and he says he was a paperboy. If we flash forward into episode 3 of Season 7, we actually get to see him as a paperboy for a couple seconds here on screen, and I thought that was pretty cool. Another thing, attention to detail here, they really stuck to the canon of what they laid down previously, and I really enjoyed that. And if you guys want a full theory on who I think actually pulled the lever for Movie Night Massacre, I made a full cartoon theory on that. You guys can check out the link in the description. But anyway, that's all the Easter eggs that I have for you guys today. Remember that we are doing a giveaway, guys. Like I said, you have to be subscribed, like the video, and comment down below. Get your bonus entries by liking me on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. All those things will link down in the description. You guys want to enter for your chance to win the art book. Super cool stuff going on there. Thank you guys so much for watching this video. If you guys are fans of Venture Bros like I am, be sticking with me for more of these videos. It'll be coming out very, very soon. Episode 4 is coming out Friday. All the episodes drop out on AdultSwim.com on Friday, and then they drop out on television on Sunday night. So I'll probably be having next week's video out a few days earlier than I did this one. But until next time, guys, remember that it is always KMAC time somewhere. Until then, take it easy and peace out. Go Team Venture.